My name is Jack Cummings. I am the artistic director of Transport Group, and I was the director of I Remember Mama. A few years back, I was directing a death scene. You know, a scene in which a character dies. In the midst of working on this death scene, it occurred to me that trying to direct it might actually be the death of me. It was 2014, and the production was I Remember Mama. The scene involved three stalwart actresses, Lynn Cohen, Phyllis Somerville, and Barbara Andres. Unfortunately for me, the scene involved that dreaded of all things when you are short on rehearsal time, props. Three small glasses and one liquor bottle. Interspersed with the dialogue, Phyllis had to gather the aforementioned props, pour the liquor into each of the glasses, and hand Lynn and Barbara their drinks, culminating in each of them raising their glasses and saying, "Skull." This was immediately followed by Uncle Chris dying. One might rightfully ask, "So what was the big deal?" Come, I tell you. I Remember Mama is a play from 1944 by John Van Druten, and it is a collection of small stories that tell about the lives of a Norwegian immigrant family in San Francisco around the turn of the century. In many ways, I Remember Mama is a very traditional play, and I love that about it, but I also wanted to approach it from a different perspective that was still somehow related to the play. The play deals with memory. It has a framing device of the oldest daughter looking back. And so I thought, I wonder what the play would feel like if 10 older actors in their 80s, all women, were the ones telling this story. The depth of what's really happening in the play in these small, seemingly everyday moments would really rise to the surface in a way when seen through their perspectives. Their age, by nature, gives everything a certain gravitas that makes you look at it a little bit differently, and in my opinion, makes you feel it deeper. When we started the whole process for the production, I felt very secure in the idea, and it was very exciting just to kind of bring all of these 10 older actresses together. Dane Laffrey, our set designer, had designed a set for the production, 10 dining room tables in the round. I was very excited by it, as was Dane, and we felt we were really onto something. And forgetting that these actors were older, and this was a very conceptual set, when I presented that to them, they basically were like, no. It was not working. It was not working for a thousand reasons. What I hadn't counted on was that we were all together creating a theatrical language of where are we, why are we here, what does this table represent, how does it work when one actor is a great aunt in one scene and a little boy in another. And so that takes a process, and it takes faith, and it takes patience when you fail, which you're going to a lot, until you figure out how can we communicate a level of reality while also living very theatrically at the same time. The moment I felt there was a tiny light was when Dane Laffer, our set designer, said, "I think you should just have them run it." We were in tech, just have them run it, and no one can be allowed to stop. And so I sat the actors down. I said, "We're just gonna run this, warts and all. I'm gonna make the decision right now that everything that happens in this run is great." Something happened where they just had a sense of freedom about it for the very first time. And we got through it. And I think for me, that was when I knew 100% that we could do it. Everything was there for it to happen. We just had to keep creating the space in which it could happen. And I do remember the first preview, that audience could see what I was seeing. They were very much connecting to these women in an intense way that even I hadn't quite anticipated. I had hoped for it, but I didn't anticipate it actually being a reality, and it was. There was a scene in the play in the second act that I truly thought I was going to lose my mind. In this scene, Uncle Chris, played by Lynn Cohen, is dying, and he is summoned his favorite niece, who was Barbara Andres, who played Mama, and his current wife, who Phyllis Somerville played, into his bedroom one last time before he dies for a final toast. All of a sudden, everything became confusing. You know, no, I want it after this line. I thought you said after this line. No, and only pour this amount. I did pour that amount. No, it's a little too much. Should we go back to the top? No, I don't want to go back to the top. I want to make sure this is right now. Nope, that was wrong. I need it on this word. I thought you said this word. And it just became this spiral drowning situation. Every time I tried to intervene and clarify or help, it just made it worse. And Phyllis was going insane, Lynn was going insane. It just seemed like it was this never-ending cycle of two actors getting more and more annoyed at the situation and then getting more and more and more personally annoyed and irritated with each other. They weren't meshing. There wasn't like a process chemistry. I also think at that age, you're not necessarily afraid to kind of let it be known how you feel. Despite that, they never lost sight as individuals and as fellow actors of the story they were trying to tell. It never stopped them from doing the work. And I thought that was incredible. Lynn and Phyllis are no longer with us. Lynn died in February and Phyllis died in July. I tell this story because I've been thinking about them a lot lately, and for some reason, this death scene always pops into my head first. These two women were physically tiny, but gigantic when it came to being an artist. Lynn was 80 at the time and Phyllis was 70. Their artistry was effortless yet layered, complex yet clear, surprising yet plausible. And even though their individual process drove each other's individual process insane, they never let that stop them from pursuing the truest way to give that story to the audience every night. It sounds simple, but they held in the highest regard the pursuit of just telling the truth. And that can be more difficult to achieve than one thinks, you know, but an audience can feel it. Phyllis and Lynn, and the rest of them for that matter, were just masters about telling the truth. I think that was the ultimate secret weapon of the whole production. Right before Uncle Chris's death scene, he has one last moment with his teenage great-niece, Katrin. As Katrin leaves the room, she quietly says, "Goodbye, Uncle Chris." He stops her and asks her to say it in Norwegian. Katrin complies and says, "Farvel, Uncle Chris." Farvel, Lynn. Farvel, Phyllis. Skål. Transport Group is celebrating our 20th anniversary. We are fortunate to have an incredible body of work behind us, but we have so many more stories we want to tell, so many more important, incredible voices we want to amplify. We ask for your support in helping us make the future happen. Please visit transportgroup.org to donate.